Hi, I'm Nancy Huber, and I wanted to give you some information about Our Place Childcare Ministry here at Lawrence United Methodist Church. When the shutdown first happened, some unfortunate things happened. We did close the daycare for 2 weeks, and our director, Jeannie Miller, who'd been here almost 20 years, became ill and had to retire. But in the meantime, when we did reopen on April the 6th, for the parents that had to go back to work, our staff, dedicated staff, decided amongst themselves to cut their hours so that they could cover the time when the children were here. Several of the parents, even though they were working from home and keeping their children at home, decided to pay their tuition so that we could continue to pay the staff. Mr. James, who's been here 19 years, stepped up and is acting director. One of the parents surprised the staff by giving them, sharing with them their stimulus check. What a blessing Lawrence United Methodist Church has with Our Place Child Care Ministry.
And welcome to worship at Lawrence United Methodist Church. This is the day the Lord has made. What shall we do? Rejoice and be glad in it. We are so glad that you have chosen to spend part of your morning with us through our online worship. And we claim God's promise that where two or three are gathered in His name, whether we're in one place or many, He is here with us. Want to also remind you about many other opportunities we have to connect with one another and with God during this time. We have our windshield worship on Sunday mornings at 10:30. We also have 3 different spiritual growth classes that meet on Sundays, our Tuesday morning Bible study, Wednesday prayer group, and all those details can be found on our website and on our Facebook page. We also have opportunities for the children and for the youth. Beginning today, they're meeting in the parking lot in a socially distanced way to get to be together. Want to also encourage you, most of you should have received in the mail a copy of our re-entry survey. This can be filled out and mailed back to the church or dropped in the offering bucket at Windshield Worship, or you can go online. The link is also on our website. So check that out, because we want to hear your feedback as we continue to prayerfully prepare to re-enter the building for in-building worship at some point. We don't know when that will be yet, but we are prayerfully preparing and studying for that time, and we would love for your feedback. The deadline is next Sunday, July 5th, is when we do need your information back. So be part of that process with us as we seek God's will through all of this. As we begin our time of worship, I want to invite you to take a deep breath and feel God's presence with you and His amazing love.
Hello, little people, and hello, big people. I have something that I really, really want to talk to you about today, but first, we have to wait. And I've set a timer here for 15 seconds, 15 whole seconds, we need to wait. So I'm going to hit the start button, and we're going to wait. Time's up, time's up. Man, I thought that 15 seconds was going to last forever. Have you ever had to wait for something? Right, it can be really frustrating when you're waiting for something, especially something that you really want, like maybe you're waiting for your birthday and you're ready for presents and cake, but it's just not quite there yet. Waiting can be really, really difficult. And as a matter of fact, in the Bible, there's a story about two friends, Mary and Martha, who were waiting for Jesus. They were so excited and they kept looking out and seeing if he was coming, you know, and it started to get frustrating for them. But eventually Jesus shows up. And what I want to tell you today is that sometimes we might pray and ask God for something, and we might feel like God is making us wait. We might feel like it might last forever. Maybe we prayed for someone in our family to be healed, or maybe we really prayed for something that we wanted. But God wants us to know that when we pray and we ask for something, that God keeps His promises and that He always shows up on time, not necessarily when we want it to or when we want things to, but God is always on time and God always shows up when we need Him. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank You so much for being there when we need You. Lord, teach us to be patient as we wait for You. In the name of Jesus, amen.
God loves. God loves. Oh, thank you. Hey, boy, I tell you, it's been one of those days. But hey, I'm glad to see you, and I'm glad to be here. Hey, I just want to let you know things are going well, you know, on the job hunt. I actually landed a job at a calendar factory, but I got fired because I took a day off. But hey, you know how those things go. But you know that my boss, you know, he came to me and he asked me, he said, well, hey, who's the stupid one around here, you or me? And I told him, I said, hey, we all know that you don't hire stupid people. You know, so anyway, I left that job too. So, but anyway, I'm glad you're here and I'm glad you're able to give. And because you give, Lawrence United Methodist give. Thank you for laughing, and thank you for giving, because God loves a cheerful giver.
As we come to this time of prayer, I will share a short prayer and will conclude with, Lord, hear my prayer. We as a congregation can respond, Lord, hear our prayer. We'll have a few moments of quiet, during which time you are invited to lift up your prayer requests to the Lord, your concerns, your joys, and at the end of which we as a family of believers, though we're separated by distance, can be connected by heart as we join together in saying, Lord, hear our prayer. We'll continue by sharing the Lord's Prayer together. Let us pray. Almighty, loving, and gracious God, we come to you on this new day, grateful for your great love for us. We are thankful, Lord, that you are with us in each moment of our lives, even when we may not remember. We come to you this day with many things on our hearts, some with great burdens of grief, concern, or fear for the future. Some come with great joys for answers to prayers having been realized, the tangible signs of your hand in their lives. Some are searching for answers for next steps to take. Some are ill who pray for healing or for relief from pain. There's turmoil in our nation, Lord, and we cry out for peace in the streets and in the hearts of men and women. We lift all these up to you, mighty God. Thank you for hearing our prayers and knowing our needs. Thank you for your great mercy and love on which we can rely. We pray to be open to your Holy Spirit, Lord, and strive to be blessings for your kingdom. Lord, hear my prayer. In these quiet moments, Lord, please hear the prayers of the people. Lord, hear our prayer. Let us continue now in the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Today's scripture lesson comes to us from the book of John, chapter 11, verses 1 through 6, and 25 through 27. Now a certain man was ill, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. It was Mary who anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was ill. So the sisters sent to him, saying, Lord, he whom you love is ill. But when Jesus heard it, he said, This illness is not unto death. It is for the glory of God, so that the Son of God may be glorified by means of it. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that he was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? She said to him, Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, he who is coming into the world. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Would you pray with me? Mighty God, we pray that the words of our mouths and the meditations of our hearts will be acceptable in your sight. Lord, our strength, our rock, and our redeemer. In Jesus' name we pray, and let us all say, Amen. My cousin was having a real bad day, having problems at work, problems with her patients. She was lonely. And she prays to God, and she says, God, please take away my problems. And if you can't do that, just give me someone to share my problems with. She said, Amen. Started to drive home on the highway and got a flat tire. How many of you have a hard time with waiting? Have a hard time with waiting on dinner? Have a hard time waiting for work to end? Have a hard time waiting on my kids? Have a hard time waiting on my spouse? That's me. But sometimes I have a real hard time waiting on God. This is the last Sunday of our sermon series that we've been looking at the question, why? And today I want to specifically ask the question, why is it that God sometimes waits to do something? Why is it that sometimes God waits to do something? I don't know what the something is in your life. It might be your finances. It might be your medical history. It might be a social justice issue. You might even be sitting right next to the it. It might be someone that you're married to or someone that you gave birth to. And you're wondering, God, why haven't you done something about it? And we end up waiting and waiting and waiting. But I want to share with you today that a waiting season with God is not a wasted season. Let me say that again. A waiting season with God is not a wasted season. I think a perfect example of that is in our scripture lesson from today. It's from the Gospel of John, and it's the story of two sisters, Mary and Martha, and they've got a brother. You know the brother's name. His name is Lazarus, right? Now, Mary and Martha, they're really close friends with Jesus. Jesus came to their house and ate. They have a relationship. And so when the brother Lazarus gets sick, they send word to Jesus that Lazarus is sick, and they just absolutely know that Jesus is going to come. Because this is your friend, Jesus. Because we're your people, Jesus. They know he's going to come. They've heard about how Jesus has done miracles for others. Certainly he will do it for them. Here's what it says in the scripture, John 11, 1 through 3. Now a certain man was ill, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. It was Mary who anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was ill. So the sisters sent to him saying, Lord, he whom you love is ill. They don't even have to tell Jesus his name. It's like, Jesus, your best friend. Jesus, your people. Jesus, your main man. He's not doing well. We need you to come by. And so they wait, and Jesus doesn't show up. And I can imagine they're telling Lazarus, hold on, man. Jesus loves you. He's coming. Hold on. And the next day, just hold on a little bit longer. We know Jesus is coming. He's your buddy. He's been at our house. We gave him seconds and we didn't even ask him to do the dishes. Jesus is coming. I don't know if you've ever done this, but sometimes you start trying to convince God of reasons why God needs to do something for us. Remember? And maybe that's what they're thinking as it comes to Jesus. Lazarus, you're a good person. Certainly Jesus is coming. Lazarus, he's done it for others. Certainly he's going to do it for you. Lazarus, he loves you. He's coming. I want to make a point to you. God's delays aren't necessarily God's denials. God's delays aren't necessarily God's denials. In other words, just because God hasn't done it yet, it doesn't mean that God's not going to do something. Let me give you an example in my ministry. I remember once that felt like God was telling me to create a ping pong ministry at an apartment complex. So I kind of got the money together and got the plan together. And I remember going over to the apartment complex and giving them the whole plan. And guess what? They wanted nothing to do with me. Nothing at all. And I remember leaving and I'm thinking, God, I thought that that's what you wanted from me. Why? Well, I waited about a year. And then someone came to my office and they said, you know, we're from that apartment complex and we are looking for a partner to do some ministry. And I said, oh, you must have got a hold of my proposal, right? And the guy said, no, I don't know anything about you. He says, we just bought that apartment complex and we're looking for a church to do a partnership with. Well, guess what? It was like God's answer to the prayer. I showed him the entire plan, and he asked me, well, when can you start? We started about 2 weeks later. It was an amazing thing. And what I learned from that is this, is that God's denials or God's delays aren't necessarily God's denials. And so we had a wonderful ministry there. I'm going to show you some pictures of some of the things that we did there. Well, 3 years later, They ended up selling again, and we lost the ability to do that ministry at that apartment complex. Once again, I had a choice. Am I going to be in despair? Am I going to be wondering why? Or am I going to trust that God's delays aren't God's denials? Well, this time, after going through that process, I trusted that God had a plan and a purpose. And today, just this morning, we had a ping pong ministry with about 20 kids right here at the church. And what it teaches me is, in the midst of all things, God is working good. I saw this picture. It says this: Joseph waited 13 years before God got him out of prison. Abraham waited 25 years before Isaac was born. Moses waited 40 years before he brought the children of Israel to the edge of the promised land. Jesus waited 30 years before he began his earthly ministry. If God is making you wait, you're in good company. God's delays aren't always God's denials. Just because God hasn't answered your prayer yet doesn't mean that he won't. In fact, in the case of Lazarus, Jesus knew all about the problem. It says this in John 11:4. But when Jesus heard it, he said, "This illness is not unto death. It is for the glory of God, so that the Son of God may be glorified by means of it." In other words, Jesus is saying, I know exactly what's going on, and guess what? I'm still in control. When I think about the story of Lazarus, I don't think it's really about Lazarus. I think it's about God's purpose. It's a sign that we can trust God, and it's a sign that Jesus can be trusted even when there seems to be no hope at all. Not every one of us is going to have a Lazarus experience, but we all can experience life after death and life more abundantly through Jesus Christ. God's purpose is greater than your plan. God's purpose is greater than your pain. And God's purpose is even greater than your prayers. Think about it. What God gives to us here is only temporary, but God's purpose is eternal. So here's another point I want to make. Sometimes God wants to change something in us before God changes something for us. Sometimes God wants to change something in us before God changes something for us. This morning I put up a post on Facebook and I asked the question, what has God taught you while you waited for God to do something in your life? Let me share some of the responses. And Pemberton Burton said, God taught her patience. Margaret Mayo said that she learned that God is in charge no matter how much I want to be. Clorinda Crawford, one of our former pastors here, said she learned to take the gifts that God's given to her and work to change the world. That's what Jesus' followers are here to do. Taylan Shea said that she learned that God has a different plan and that she wanted the wrong things. God had a bigger and better plan than what I had for myself. Adriana Escato said, God taught me that sometimes I already have what I'm asking God for. Thad Riley said, God taught me that what I was waiting for was far inferior to God, to his presence, his goodness, and his love. Debbie Kudnick Miller said, she learned that everything will be okay in the end. And if it's not okay now, it's not the end. Angela Wilson said, while waiting for him to deliver me to the next, there was something else to learn in the now. Willie Watts said, God is with me in the waiting. Well, to my surprise, when I wrote that post, more than 80 people responded. All of us can preach a sermon about what we've learned while we've been waiting on God. There was a mother who was very upset with her daughter's bad behavior. The little girl kept misbehaving. And so the mother says to the little girl, if you don't stop misbehaving, I'm going to tell your grandparents about how bad you're acting. The little girl said, oh, mommy, please don't tell them, please. I want to surprise them. Well, the surprise to Mary and Martha was that Lazarus died. That Jesus didn't show up. That he didn't arrive. And I can imagine the question that they're asking is, where is Jesus? You know what the answer is? He's out healing a Roman soldier. He's healing our enemies. But he doesn't heal his close friend. It doesn't seem to make sense. Jesus finally arrives, and it's not just too late, it's insultingly late. It's rudely late. Lazarus has died. They already had the funeral, and he's already been buried in the tomb for days. Not only didn't you make it in time, Jesus, but you weren't even here to comfort us when we were mourning. Have you ever felt like that? Like God let you down? Like God was too late? God, you could have done it. God, you've done it for others. God, I believed, I hoped, I prayed for it, and yet you did not show up. In John 11, 20 and 21, it says, when Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him while Mary stayed in the house. Mary didn't even want to come out and see him. Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. I pulled out an old Bible that my mother gave to me and read the story, John 11, from that Bible. And it's interesting. Everything bad seems to happen on page 73. On page 73, Lazarus dies. On page 73, Mary is upset. On page 73, Martha is depressed. Everything bad happens on page 73, but then I flip the page. And when I flip the page, the whole tone of everything changes. Here's what Martha ends up saying. Martha says in John 11, 22, but even now, I know that whatever you ask from God, God will give to you. She has an even now moment. Though she feels dead on the inside, she has an even now moment on the outside, and she still has a hope and faith in Jesus. Some of us right now, we need to have an even now moment. Some of us have been stuck on page 73, and we need to turn the page and trust that God is still able and willing in our lives. We need to believe that God's delays aren't a denial to us and that God is still working within us even now. I told this story before, but let me tell it again. A few years ago, an ambulance came through the neighborhood, and many of us were working on the Methodist house. And it was a page 73 moment. Someone was hurt. Someone was in need. But we turned the page. See, we remembered that the week before, Dick Robinson had been in Bible study. And Dick Robinson said, every time I hear an ambulance, I bow my head and pray for whoever is in need. Well, Dick Robinson and the rest of us bowed our heads and we prayed. And that ambulance kept coming through the neighborhood. Sirens blaring, and it actually stopped right in front of the Methodist house. The paramedics jump out of the ambulance and they've got their gear together. And they say, we're looking for a 90-year-old by the name of Richard. And all of us say, a 90-year-old by the name of Richard, huh? Oh, we don't know. And all of a sudden, Dick says, wait a minute. My name is Richard, and I'm 90 years old. Well, come to find out, Dick Robinson had sat down and accidentally set off his life alert medallion, which was in his pocket, and the ambulance was for him. So even now, as Dick was praying, he had no idea that he was praying for himself. Even now, as help was arriving, he had no idea that it was for himself. And I want to say that Martha was having an even now moment. Here she was praying for her brother, that God would do something for her brother. And first, Jesus says, no, wait a minute. First, I want to change something in you. Here's what Jesus says. Jesus says in John 11, 25, Jesus says to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he dies, yet shall he live. He's saying there is a time coming when I'm going to sacrifice my life on the cross for you, that even though you die, that doesn't have to be the end, that we can have eternal life with our heavenly Father even now. And guess what Martha says? Martha says, yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who should come into the world. Can I tell you something? First of all, God changes something in her before God changes something for her. First of all, the change happens within her. And the most important change is that confession of faith. The most important lasting change is what happens to her on the inside. Not the change that comes to Lazarus on the outside. Jesus says in John 11, 43 and 44, when he heard this, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. The dead man came out. His hands and feet were bound, and his face was wrapped with a cloth. And Jesus said to them, unbind him and let him go. God didn't give them what they expected, but Jesus far exceeded their expectations. Jesus didn't give them what they thought would be a timely response, but he was right on time. If you're in a waiting season, I want you to remember it's not a wasted season. Remember that God wants to change something within you before he changes something for you. My cousin was having a real bad day. She was having problems with her work, problems with her patients. She was feeling lonely. She prayed, God, please take my problems away. And if you won't take my problems away, at least send me someone that I might share my problems with them. She said, amen, and drove home from work and got a flat tire on the highway. Well, you can imagine, there she is on the highway, head down, crying, waiting, not knowing what to do. Someone pulls in behind her and a gentleman gets out, knocks on the window, and he says, would you like me to change your tire, or is your husband on the way to change your tire? She said, I'm not married. He asked, why aren't you married? And she said, because I haven't met Mr. Wright yet. He said, let me introduce myself. God's plans are always better than ours. Amen. Amen.
What do you do when you've done all you can and seem like it's never enough? Oh, what do you say when your friends turn away and you're all alone, all alone? Tell me, what do you give when you've given your all and seem like you can't make it through? Well, you just stand when there's nothing left to do. You stand, watch the Lord see you through after you've done all you can. You just stand. Tell me, how do you handle the guilt of your past? Tell me, how do you deal with the strain? Oh, and how can you smile when your world has been broken and filled with pain, filled with pain? Tell me, what do you give when you've given your all and you seem like you can't make it through? Well, you just stand when there's nothing left to do. You stand, watch the Lord see you through. Yes, after you've done all you can, you just stand. Oh, 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 oh. You stand.
Friends, as always, it's been such a joy to be in worship with you. I have already made up my mind that I'm coming back next Sunday. I hope you make up your mind as well, too. I hope you join in worship no matter where you are, whether you come and join us at the windshield worship or if you catch us online. Be sure to give God the honor and glory that He deserves. Please receive this benediction. To God be all glory, honor, and power, now and forevermore. In Jesus' name we pray, and let us all say, amen. Friends, remember, wash your hands and say your prayers, because germs and Jesus are everywhere. Love you. God bless you. Bye-bye.
We're on our way.
I can't wait to get there.
How much longer?
Oh man, I gotta go to the restroom.
Man, I'm so glad Corporate keeps their bathrooms clean and sanitized.
Welcome to Corporate. What can I get for you guys?
Maybe the Lord's
Cup. I would like mini corn dogs.
A butter burger, but with just cheese.
Man, I love the butter burger. It's delicious.
Culver's custard is the best.
That's so refreshing.
So on July 1st, come to the Culver's on Post Road, order lunch and dinner, and tell them that you're with the Lawrence Youth Corps.
See you on July 1st!